Dr. Sandeep completed his MBBS and then MS Orthopedics, and also fellowship in rheumatology and also another fellowship in pain management. He is presently the consultant orthopedic surgeon and pain management specialist at SV Multispeciality Hospital, Dr. Kamakshi Memorial Hospital, Arun Vijaya Hospital, Rekha Hospital, and Sri Vasavi Hospital. And he is also the joint secretary of IMA Kodambakkam. He's had a wonderful academic career with the Young Achiever Award, Best Paper Award, and Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Excellency Gold Medal Award by All India Achievers Academy in 2019. He's had many original research papers and he's got a varied areas of interest. Over to you, Dr. Sandeep, for the pain, for talking about the painful shoulder.
Thank you very much, Dr. Priya, for giving me a kind, nice introduction. Is it visible, madam?
Yes, it is. Yes, and you're audible as well.
Yes, madam. Good evening to all our members. First of all, I would like to thank the office bearers and the academic committee of our Kodambakkam branch for giving me this opportunity. Today, let us discuss a few important things about a very common condition about in the general practice with pertaining to orthopedics about the shoulder joint. Shoulder joint is the third most common orthopedic condition presenting to a general practitioner's clinic. A small anatomy of the shoulder joint. We think shoulder joint is a one joint, but it is not. It comprises of four joints, that is the sternoclavicular, scapulothoracic joint, acromioclavicular joint, and the glenohumeral joint. The maximum movement occurs at the glenohumeral joint, and that is where our concentration will be, but the other joints also are of very much importance. Shoulder joint is a very peculiar joint in its anatomy because it is the most mobile joint in the body. But to gain this mobility, stability has been sacrificed. So as you can see here, up to 90 degrees of the shoulder movement will occur at the glenohumeral joint, after which the scapulothoracic joint starts moving. You can see how mobile the joint is. So because to gain this mobility, the stability has been sacrificed, and it shows that that is why the shoulder joint is the most dislocated joint in the body. So the causes of shoulder pain can be broadly classified as traumatic and non-traumatic as an initial part. Traumatic, I'll just touch upon, very easy to diagnose. It can be either dislocation or fractures, or it can be a contusion. Contusion, there will be only pain, a minimal tenderness, or no restriction of movements. But in dislocation and fractures, there will be some movement restriction. I'll explain in the next slide. But in post-traumatic, that is after 2-3 weeks of the initial trauma, there will be shoulder pain. That can be pertained to these four conditions, like post-immobilization pain or stiffness, the ligament injury, non-union or malunion, or if there is any neurological conditions. That depends on the problem, and each topic is a specialized topic by itself. As you see, if a patient presents to us with a trauma, we can see that he will be presenting like this. You can see the left shoulder, there is fullness, but in the right shoulder, there is some deficit. This is called as a sulcus sign, mainly very common in dislocations. So when you ask the patient to do a Dugas test, that is, you ask the patient to touch the opposite shoulder. Normally, we can be able to touch the opposite shoulder without any pain or restriction of movement. But in a dislocated patient, they will not be able to do so. That is the test for shoulder dislocation clinically. If you don't have any radiological investigation which is available with you, to test for any dislocation, the test for diagnosis is Dugas test. Next, we have to check for axillary nerve. That is, there will be paresthesia or loss of sensation over the delta tuberosity here. So that is called as a regimental badge sign. We can see that the shoulders wear their badge here. So that that area can be anesthetized. That is because of shoulder dislocation. quite common. It does not affect the management part, but medico-legally it is very important because during manipulation of the shoulder for the shoulder reduction, the patient will complain. After the shoulder reduction, he's complaining of some loss of sensation at the delta tuberosity. They may claim it that because the doctor has manipulated the shoulder, he has loss of sensations after that. So initial examination, axillary nerve examination is very, very important. So when we take an X-ray, it will be either these three types, either a pure dislocation or a fracture or a combination of a both. But for fractures, I think as a general practitioner, we need to put what is called a shoulder immobilizer. But if there is a dislocation, it is a medical emergency and we can do a small maneuver which can reduce the fracture. That is the T. Please remember T, that is traction, external rotation, adduction, and medial rotation. You give traction, externally rotate the shoulder as much as possible, adduct the shoulder, and then medially rotate. That will reduce the shoulder dislocation immediately. And immediately after reduction, you can test for the Dugas test. They'll be able to do the touch the opposite shoulder. And after which we can put this shoulder immobilizer and then refer to the concerned specialist for definitive management of the condition. So mainly we have to concentrate on non-traumatic condition, which form about 90% of general practitioners OP. So what was the traditional concepts we had and what is the current understanding? We think all the shoulder pain is periarthritis or adhesive capsulitis, which is not. Periarthritis is actually not at all a clinical diagnosis. It is a clinical condition, but it's not a diagnosis. What are the current diagnosis we have? So we have an array of these kind of diagnosis possible. So these many conditions are possible in the shoulder joint, of which this frozen shoulder, it is not a diagnosis per se. It is a stiffness which is being depicted as a frozen shoulder. So let us concentrate on 4 or 5 important conditions which are very common in our day-to-day practice. But before that, I want to clear a few myths and misconceptions regarding the shoulder pain. All shoulder pains will be cured with exercise physiotherapy or will not be cured with exercise, or it becomes all right with benign neglect. All these three are correct partly and partly wrong, but it is pertaining to the exact diagnosis which I have shown in the previous slide. Few conditions do reduce with physiotherapy, few conditions does not reduce with physiotherapy, all those things. So let us see how it goes. India being diabetic capital of the whole world, we can see a lot of diabetic conditions per patients per having shoulder pain. About 2/3 of them do complain of shoulder pain. And of them, 1/3 of them have substantial pain and disability in carrying out their activities of daily living. There is a 5-fold increase in compared to the non-diabetics. There is a higher prevalence in type 2 diabetics, no association with HbA1c levels. And treatment-wise, there is higher prevalence in patients taking secretagogues because of hyperinsulinism. Nevertheless, it is always essential to rule out diabetes and pre-diabetes in suspected patients because of this paper had showed done about 13, 14 years back. It showed that the shoulder pain has been described as the most disabling of the common musculoskeletal manifestation of diabetes. It is the most common and most disabling in diabetic patients. So we'll concentrate on 4 or 5 conditions where which is much more commoner among all those diagnoses. So we will see rotator cuff impingement, frozen shoulder and adhesive capsulitis, rotator cuff tear and arthritis in that order of commonness. So impingement, what does it mean? It means that the shoulder joint, the soft tissues get impinged between the two bony prominences. As you can see, this is the acromion and this is the greater tuberosity. We can see a good amount of gap. That gap, due to various conditions, reduces. And what happens when they abduct the shoulder almost up to 90 degrees, it comes in contact with the acromion. Thereby, this problem occurs. There is impingement. So it occurs in those conditions where the acromion has is classified as type 3 anatomically. There is a hook type. So it has a sharp end which can possibly press upon the rotator cuff. So it can be easily diagnosed with an MRI, where you can see here a small hook here. So that can press upon the greater tuberosity when abducted. So impingement in diabetics, why does it occur? This paper has been an eye-opener for us, done about 5-6 years back. We never had a clue how it, the pathogenesis in diabetes. So what does it say? There is muscle fatigability in diabetics. More muscle weakness occurs, which causes muscular force imbalance among the various abductors and the adductors of the shoulder joint, thereby causing dyskinesia of the shoulder joint, which causes impingement, and the secondary frozen shoulder do occur. So the treatment is very simple. Activity of work modification, that is, first mainly modification of activities. Let us not allow the patient to abduct beyond 90 degrees initially, at least for about 2 weeks. Control the pain and inflammation with analgesics and anti-inflammatory agents. Stretching exercises can be done. After 2 weeks, we can see that there is good improvement of pain, and the activities of daily living do occur without pain. At that time, we can start strengthening exercises and later on move to overhead abduction activities. If this program does not improve the pain, then we can try subacromial injections, wherein we can inject either a steroid or a PRP into the subacromial space near the rotator cuff. Thereby, it reduces the local inflammation. If nothing is working out, we do what is called as a subacromial decompression. It is done arthroscopically, wherein we can see that hook part can be just drilled and scraped off, thereby increasing the space between the acromion and the glenoid, that is the head of the humerus. So this is the undersurface of the acromion. I have operated upon this patient about 4 days back for the same condition. This is a burr. So it keeps rotating and thereby scrapes off the undersurface of the bone. And we were able to obtain a good amount of decompression and space between the two bony landmarks. So next will be frozen shoulder. As I've told you, this is not a diagnosis per se. This is a stiff shoulder, that's all. The risk factors being diabetes, as I have told you earlier, hyper and hypothyroidism, high cholesterol levels, injuries, post-immobilization or post-surgical. Any of these things can produce any frozen shoulder. There are three stages: the painful, frozen, and thawing stage. The painful stage, the patient, we generally do not see this stage patients because there will be good range of movements, only pain. Many of the times they take any OTC medication, and then they will be able to control the pain. But this progresses to the frozen stage, wherein there is a restriction of shoulder movements dramatically. Most of our frozen shoulders belongs to this frozen stage. And next comes the thawing stage. It is characterized by spontaneous improvement of movements and reducing the pain. So should we treat them all? The question. We have to wait for 2-3 years at least for the spontaneous resolution of pain. But that is not possible. Individualized prognosis is definitely not possible. Most of the patients remain with long-term restricted motions and many residual symptoms do remain. So benign neglect attitude may not provide best results. The treatment, In the freezing stage, we give only pain relief by medicines and physiotherapy. Range of motion exercises for to maintain the range of motion and thereby and also to increase the range of motion. Intra-articular injections do help a lot. But in frozen stage, we have stretching programs and range of motion exercises mainly to maintain the pre-existing range of motion and also to improve the we'll try to improve the range of motion. Manipulation under anesthesia, wherein under short GA, we manipulate the shoulder, thereby all the adhesions are broken in the without any intervention. This is a very result-oriented procedure, very much the patients will be very happy post-procedure. But if these two fail, then arthroscopically, we have to release all the adhesions and the capsule. So that will improve the range of motion. In thawing stage, to maintain the range of motions, all the physiotherapy and exercises can be tried. Shoulder joints, I think many of us do have many questions regarding this shoulder joint, especially steroids and diabetics. We think steroids can increase the diabetics of the diabetic state sugars. This paper about taken in 2009. So this is pertaining to knee joint injections. It showed only a transient rise in the blood glucose levels up to only 24 to 48 hours, not more than that. But in shoulder joints, there was no significant change in the mean glucose levels before and after, means after the injection has been done. Except for a very few occasions, that too, it was very transient. So we may think it produces only analgesic effect and does not help in any other way, but it is not so. As you can see in this paper done about 5 years back, we can see that the results are very encouraging, and the intra-articular steroid injections decreases the presence and the amount of fibromatosis, vascular hyperplasia, fibrosis, fibroblast, etc. Thereby, we can conclude that it is actually disease modifying in all these patients. And it produces only short-term effect, agreed, but that short-term is not less than 6 weeks, because the effect of the steroid persists after up to 6 weeks. And within that 6 weeks, it is very important for us to continue physiotherapy, intensively improve the range of motion, and thereby reducing the inflammation. And by the end of the effect of the steroid, they will have good pain-free shoulder. If this injection produces no relief, what does it imply? Probably the injection is definitely not into the joint. Maybe wrong technique, wrong approach. Small needles, especially in obese patients, I generally use spinal needles to reach the joint, or I would go for an ultrasound guided injections when required, when I'm not able to palpate all the bony prominences. Or it may not work in very advanced severe disease. So, but in young age, if there is frozen shoulder, if the patient has stiffness, it is probably due to the coracohumeral ligament contractures. It does not have any role in physiotherapy or conservative management. Definitely, it will require an arthroscopic release. Coming to rotator cuff tears, as you know, the rotator cuff is formed by four muscles, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, subscapularis, and teres minor. All these four muscles form a cuff around the joint, which is deficient in the inferior aspect. That is why shoulder dislocation occurs most commonly in the inferior aspect. So a tear can be partial or complete tear. The active movements are painful, but the passive movements are pain-free. You can look here. This patient had active movements only about 30 degrees, but passively we are able to extend, lift the shoulder of up to 120 degrees without any pain. So this is a classical rotator cuff tear. And partial thickness tears are more painful than the complete tears, because the partial tears generally move with the movement of the shoulders, whereas full thickness tears, there is nothing to move there. So it keeps rubbing against the bony prominences, and thereby it will painful more. And MRA can erroneously produce more number of tears because of just edema. The edema can be sometimes misinterpreted as tears. So the repair is either with the type of the tear, either it is functional type, atrophy, tendon retraction, all these things play an important role in deciding the type of repair. But it improves the pain and range of motion and function. Healing in controlled diabetics almost similar to non-diabetics. There are different methods we can do this repair, either by using suture anchors or only sutures or all those things. This is a collection of my cases wherein different tears are repaired in a different way. You can see here, I have used only sutures or one suture anchor and knotting against the other cuff. This is the tear here, as you can see very clearly. And you can see I have used two suture anchors here. That depends on the amount and extent of the tear. In role of exercise physiotherapy cannot be underestimated in shoulder conditions, because most of our patients, more than 75% of the patients, can be treated only with physiotherapy. But an over-enthusiastic therapist and a patient can produce more damage to the shoulder. We call this as a shoulder track program. That is training, rehabilitation, and conditioning. It is based on very simple exercises which can be done at home without any specialized equipment or any specialized tools. And it is highly effective. But the key to success for this treatment is consistency. Because once the shoulder pain subsides, they generally tend to stop those exercises, which has to be continued, encouraged. So in impingement, we do postural exercises and stretching exercises in phase one. Next is strengthening exercises in phase two and strengthening exercises against the resistance in phase three. That will be decided then and there whether they belong to phase one or phase two when we clinically examine the patient. But in frozen shoulder, it is almost the same, but we do concentrate more upon the range of motion exercises rather than strengthening. So pathology is different in both. So we will go address the pathology and then practice the exercise treatment. If the pain persists even after physiotherapy, when to continue the physio? When the pain only persists only for 10 to 15 minutes, if it is dull aching, relieved with ice and rest, probably it is just a stretch pain. You can continue physiotherapy without any problem. But when not to continue, if the pain persists for more than 30 minutes, sudden onset pain and worsening the previous existing condition, probably we are dealing with something else and requires a re-evaluation of the patient and thereby following the other protocols. Re-examination may be because an iatrogenic physio-induced tear. The patient may be over-enthusiastic or the therapist may just stretch the shoulder in order to improve the range of motion, thereby they may tear the rotator cuff. Sometimes we have seen fractures post physiotherapy. All these are possible. So I have talked about steroid injection. Now PRP injection is of very importance, gaining familiarity over the past 5-6 years. As you all know, it has got various varied indications. But in shoulder conditions, probably we can try in tendinitis, bursitis, partial thickness, rotator cuff tears, early arthritis, all these things can be tried, because the PRP injection in arthritis, if there is any focal cartilage defect, can just fill in the defect and probably form a cartilage later on. In tendinitis, bursitis, it occurs as a good anti-inflammatory agent. In rotator cuff tears, mainly partial thickness tears, PRP is of very good use, because almost 9 patients out of 10 patients the partial thickness tears improved and healed only with PRP injection. Thereby, we can avoid a surgery. So it is, I do it routinely under ultrasonographic guidance. This was done by us just yesterday. Rotator cuff tear, as you can see here, this is the head of the humerus. This is the rotator cuff, a big flap here. In that position, when the patient is internally rotated, the shoulder, complete internal rotation can just stretch the rotator cuff. Thereby, we are able to see a small gap here, a defect in the rotator cuff. We can just put the needle there and then inject it. It is a very good result-oriented procedure. And facts to carry, more than 70% of the shoulder conditions can be treated only with physiotherapy. It should address the basic pathological process and should not be over-enthusiastic. For that, a proper diagnosis and examination is of very much importance. Intra-articular steroid is disease-modifying. Not all MRI tears require surgery. Only if those very much painful or unstable joints require surgery. And when indicated, an arthroscopic surgery is very, very effective. This is the most important slide of my presentation. As you can see, the patient may come to us with shoulder pain, but never ever touch the shoulder immediately. First, examine the neck. Because almost 60% of the patients, though they complain of shoulder pain, actually have a neck pain. And the shoulder pain is secondary to that. Examination of neck is very, very important here. And coming to the shoulder per se, we can ask about the history of instability. Where if the answer is yes, then probably instability we can directly diagnose as some rotator cuff tear or there is something called as Hill Sachs lesions for recurrent dislocation of shoulder. All those things in that terms we can think of. If there is no instability, then we'll examine the acromioclavicular joint, because that is the second common condition in the shoulder. Most probably they will have acromioclavicular arthritis. That joint can undergo arthritis, and the overhead abduction can be painful in those patients. If the external rotation is reduced, then the pathology is in the glenohumeral joint. That come there only the frozen shoulder, arthritis, all those things are common. If the pain is on abduction with the thumb down, that is the thumb facing down like this. If the pain, patient is not able to lift beyond 90 degrees, this is called as a painful arc. That is, a painful arc extends from 30 degrees of abduction to almost 110, 120 degrees. So that is where an impingement will occur. So once the patient crosses 120 degrees, probably he will not be able to have much pain. And we definitely have to examine the other hand also, other shoulder also, to rule out any neck conditions. Last but not the least, these are the red flags, what we see in the conditions. Any mass or swelling, we may deal with tumor or infection if there is any swelling accompanied with all signs of inflammation. Or dislocation, I have told you earlier how to diagnose it. Or an acute cuff tear, all these things are possible. And I would like to make a mention here, I have not touched upon the referred pain to the shoulder. As you all know, referred pain can occur from cardiac conditions or even stomach conditions also. That pertaining to that clinical history, we can diagnose those conditions. Prevention of shoulder pain, a small word for all of us, regular exercises, control of diabetes if you are already diabetic, and active lifestyle can prevent 95% of your shoulder conditions. Good, active, regular exercises consistently, if you do that, probably you will not have any shoulder pain in your lifetime. Thank you very much for your patient listening. And with life is movement. Without movement, life is unthinkable. Thank you very much. I'll be very happy to answer your questions if there are any.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. The floor is open for discussion and for if there are any questions, Dr. Sandeep, please. Sorry. No questions to Dr. Sandeep?
In the association with diabetes,
yes, sir.
Is it because of any related hyperinsulinemia? Is that more with type 2 diabetes, and is it with associated with type hyperinsulinemia?
So basically, in hyperinsulinemia, the hyperinsulinemia will control diabetes by reducing only the blood sugar levels. So it is being pushed out of the circulatory volume, the sugars. So what happens is, in diabetics especially, there will be some amount of fibrosis inherently. So this sugars are increased in the synovial fluid in the shoulder joint, and it gets deposited in the capsule, which causes further contractures. So thereby the shoulder can become stiff.
Okay. So Dr. Shanmugasundaram, sir, you had raised your hand. Do you want to ask something?
Yes, sir. Dr. Sandeep, it's a good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
In the early part of the disease, do you advise the rotational movement? Like in the most of the corporation parks and all, you would have seen the wheel, the good wheel, big wheel.
Yes, sir. That is called as a mariner's wheel, sir.
Do you advise those exercises in the early part of the
disease? Sir, it all depends on, as I have told you, the patients do not present to us in the early part. I mean to say, they will have pain, but there will be no restriction of movements which will be hampering their activities of daily living. Only in the advanced stage only they present to us most of the times, 90% of the times. So in that case, first we will try to improve the range of motion exercises freehand. First, we have to do some freehand exercises, physiotherapy, reduce the inflammation, and then progressively over a period of 1 week to 10 days, we can start that wheel exercises, all those things, sir. Even there is something called as a supination pronation arm also in physiotherapy departments. So sometimes when you supinate and pronate the forearm with the elbow extended, the movement occurs at the shoulder joint. Many a times that will also be restricted. So that will produce good relief of symptoms, but it should be started only in the later stage of the treatment, when the patient is able to lift up to more than 90 degrees without much pain, freehand, not with any assistance or not with much pain. Then only we have to advise all those equipment related exercises.
We often see patients who have been getting steroid injections, for example. Sir? Which type of steroid do you advise? Like, for example, do you triamcinolone, or which type of steroid do you?
I generally use either methylprednisolone or triamcinolone, sir.
Fine. Okay. Thank you.
Either of the two, whichever is available, sir.
Okay.
It will be only a one-shot injection. I will not repeat it. I will not go for the steroid injection again. If the condition recurs, then probably I would go for PRP injection instead of steroid.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Sandeep, when you do PRP, do you prefer to take it from the peripheral blood or from the marrow?
No, peripheral blood. Definitely only from the peripheral blood. We never touch the marrow. Marrow PRP is for all neurological conditions, all spine-related conditions, not for this joint injections.
And what about the use of collagen? Is that any useful here or no?
No role for collagen, because it does not address the pathology is different here.
Okay. So all these things don't work here.
Yeah. Collagen supplements may not be effective, because only in arthritis, but shoulder arthritis is quite rare because it's a non-weight bearing joint.
How efficacious is this PRP, Sandeep?
Sir, it is very efficacious, sir. Of about 10 patients, 8 patients of them in a clearly indicated case patients, it can avoid surgeries.
Okay. Especially, and how do you decide the quantity? How much to give, and how do you decide that?
Sir, normally about 3 to 4 ml, we get about 30 ml of patient's blood, the peripheral blood is harvested, and then it is centrifuged, sir. We get about 3 to 4 ml. Beyond that, we will not be able to inject. We will not be able to inject into the shoulder joint. Maximum 5 ml of any fluid can be injected. Post that, the capsule will start to dilate, which is very painful. We generally don't give any local anesthesia also for all these patients, because it's a single prick.
Oh, okay.
And how long you wait after the PRP to see any results at all? Because I understand it's a little slow process.
PRP injection, we generally advise shoulder immobilization for about 2 weeks.
Okay.
2 weeks, yes. So 2 weeks, they will be able to work on a computer. They'll be able to write. Only thing is they will not be able to abduct the shoulder. Mm. They can keep the shoulder like this and they can write. No, without any complaint. The only thing is small modification. They have to keep the keyboard in the lap or something like that. They have to do that. So after 2 weeks, we have to start physiotherapy to two things, to strengthen the muscles and to avoid stiffness.
Okay.
Sandeep, very interesting. I just wanted to share,
yes,
what is the role of physiotherapy? Because my own sister had this problem. And
yes,
immediately he was advised surgery.
Okay.
And then I went to Bombay and then physiotherapy was given. And a role of, she had diabetic and good diabetic control and physiotherapy. With that, she recovered fully. Want to share the anecdote actually.
As I have told in my presentation, more than 75% of the conditions do improve with only physiotherapy alone.
Thank you.
We never jump into surgery without trying a course of physiotherapy until unless it is an absolutely indicated. A completely torn rotator cuff has no role of physiotherapy.
Correct.
Such conditions, we can directly go to surgery. Partial tears or any of these other conditions, if there is only relative indications, we always give a trial of physiotherapy because it's not an emergency. We can always try for about 2 to 3 weeks. If there is no improvement at all, then probably surgery can be contemplated.
An intra-articular injection of steroids, at what point do you give?
I generally wait for 10 days of physiotherapy. If that is not producing at least 50% of pain relief, then I would plan for intra-articular injections.
Thank you so much, Sandeep.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
I'm sorry, but this will be that would have been the last query that we would have taken for Sandeep. I know everybody has got something or other in terms of shoulder pain or knee pain or something. But sorry, Sandeep, we wish to have lots of discussions with you.
No problem,
with the aches and pains that
always,
we already have.
I'm always available on WhatsApp. They can even directly message me regarding this.
Absolutely. Dr. Sandeep is our joint secretary. He's there and all his number is there in all the groups. So feel free to contact him for any more